All school children know the story of the pilgrims arriving in the New World in 1620 with their Bibles in hand, seeking a new land free of religious persecution. But very few know the 300 years of struggles that took place leading up to that event that enabled them to have a Bible translated into a language that they could read and understand.
The Bible was originally written in Greek. In 400 AD, Jerome translated the Bible into Latin. By the middle centuries, only scholars and priests were still able to read and understand Latin. Therefore, most common men, which were mostly uneducated, could not read or understand the Bible. Dr. Gary Zustiak, a biblical professor at Ozark Christian College, explains.
So the only way that you could learn about God is to go to church and have the priest tell you. And one of the things that they did to help that was, especially in the ancient medieval churches, they had a lot of stained glass and they had a lot of icons, they had a lot of statues, because every one of those windows, every one of those statues would tell a significant story about the Bible.
Because the common man could not read the Bible, they had to depend on the church to tell them what God's word said. But the church would sometimes feed them false information that was not in the Bible to take advantage of them. One of the Catholic Church's false teachings was purgatory. Purgatory was taught to be like a temporary hell. But the church said if you loved the person who died very much, you could buy the person out of purgatory and into heaven. This was called the selling of indulgences.
There was a Catholic priest by the name of Tetzel who was going around to the churches and trying to get people to give money. And, you know, he would say, as soon as the drum, the coin would ring, out of purgatory your relatives will spring.
Those heretics who pretend that the lady do not need to know God's law, that the things which priests have told them is enough, do not deserve to be listened to. For the Bible is the faith of the church, and the more widely it becomes known, the better it will be. Therefore, since the lady should know the faith, it should be taught in whatever language is most easily understood. Christ and his apostles taught the people in the language best known to them.
Those were the words of John Wycliffe. John Wycliffe was well known throughout Europe for his opposition to the teaching of the organized church, which he believed to be contrary to the Bible. With the help of his followers, called Lollards, Wycliffe produced many English handwritten copies of the Bible. The Lollards soon came under attack because they preached in the streets against the unbiblical practices of the church and the government. They taught that the Bible is the only guide for how people should live. Many were arrested, tortured, and executed. John Wycliffe was so highly respected as an Oxford scholar, theologian, scientist, and minister that when tried for false teaching, he could not be convicted. Forced to retire from Oxford, John Wycliffe returned to his home church in Lutterworth, where he continued writing and preaching until his death in 1384. John Wycliffe and his disciples had such an impact on the Christian church that 41 years after his death, the Pope ordered for his grave to be opened, his bones to be burned, and his ashes to be poured into the River Swift.
That was their saying, we think this man was so evil for what he did, we're going to dishonor him in this way.
In 1408, the constitutions were formed in direct response to the overwhelming reception of Wycliffe's idea that every man should have a Bible in his own language. The constitutions forbid the sacred Latin Bible to be translated into a common tongue without express supervision of the church. It soon followed that translating scriptures into English or reading the Bible in English were heretical acts. If you broke this law, the punishment was as severe as death.
One of Wycliffe's followers, John Huss, actively promoted Wycliffe's ideas that people should oppose the tyranny of the Roman Church that threatened anyone possessing a non-Latin Bible with execution. Huss was burned at the stake in 1415, with Wycliffe's manuscript Bibles used as kindling for fire. The last words of John Huss were that, in 100 years, God will raise up a man whose call for reform cannot be suppressed. Nearly 100 years to the day, John Huss's final prayer was answered when Martin Luther nailed his 95 theses to the Wittenberg church door.
Johann Gutenberg invented the printing press in the 1450s, and that invention most certainly changed the world. The first book he printed was the Bible. To protect the secret of his new invention, Gutenberg tried to make the printing look handwritten. but the secrets of printing could not be hidden for long. Because of the invention of printing, written communication and the written word of God rapidly spread beyond the control of the wealthy and the church.
I defy the Pope and all of his laws. If God spare my life for many years, I will cause the boy who drives the plow to know more of the scriptures than you. Those were the words of William Tyndale. In 1523, William Tyndale appealed to the Bishop of London for official permission to do the English Bible translation. The permission was never granted. Tyndale knew he had to leave England to do God's work. He sailed to Hamburg in 1524. At Wittenberg, Tyndale safely began his work on the English translation of the Bible. In 1525, his initial printing effort was discovered at Cologne, but he escaped to Worms, where in 1526 he completed the first printing of the New Testament in the English language.
So what he did, he took his English Bible, but they couldn't just sell them on the streets because it's still illegal in England. So they would smuggle them into England inside bales of cloth and bales of flour and bales of cotton. Bishop Turnstall, anytime he'd find these English translations that Tyndale had printed, would burn them. But what he also did is this Bishop Tunstall, to try and get all these Bibles and keep them from out of the hands of the people, he would put the word out. He would buy as many as he could find. So he's buying all these things and he's burning them. But all the money he's buying them with went back to Tyndale, who just used the money to print more Bibles.
With the help of friends, parts of the Old Testament and Revised New Testaments were printed at Antwerp until 1535. There, a turncoat friend betrayed William Tyndale to the authorities. He continued translating the Old Testament until his martyrdom on October 6, 1536. Tyndale's last words were, "Lord, open the King of England's eyes."
At Hamburg in 1529, William Tyndale met both Miles Coverdale and John Rogers. These two friends assisted him with his work and were able to continue publishing the Bible after Tyndale's capture and death. In 1539, Coverdale completed the translation of the Old Testament and published the first edition of the entire Bible to be printed. King Henry VIII read it and 2 years later gave both Coverdale and Rogers permission to publish English Bibles. These were the first authorized Bibles. Only 3 years after Tyndale's death, his final prayer was fulfilled.
The instability of freedom continued through the 1540s and into the 1550s. After King Henry VIII, King Edward VI took the throne, and after his death, the reign of Queen Bloody Mary was the next challenge to the printing of the Bible in English. She was possessed in her quest to return England to the Roman Church. In 1555, John Rogers was burned at the stake. Mary went on to burn reformers at the stake by the hundreds for the crime of being a Protestant. This era was known as the Marian Exile, and the refugees fled from England with little hope of ever seeing their home or friends again.
In the 1550s, the Church of Geneva, Switzerland was very sympathetic to the reformer refugees and was one of only a few safe havens for desperate people. Many of them met in Geneva, led by Miles Coverdale. The New Testament was completed in 1557, and the complete Bible was first published in 1560. It was called the Geneva Bible.
Geneva Bible is the Bible that Shakespeare read, John Bunyan read, Milton, some of the greatest writers of that time in England. And you've heard of the Pilgrims, all right? You know Captain John Smith, Pilgrims. The Bible they brought to America is the Geneva Bible.
By the 1580s, the Roman Catholic Church saw that it had lost its battle. In 1582, the Church of Rome surrendered their fight for Latin only, and decided that the Bible was to be available in English. On September 16, 1620, a group of religious separatists, inspired by what they had read in the Bibles translated into English by John Wycliffe, William Tyndale, Miles Coverdale, and others, set sail from Southampton, England in search of a new world. Their ship contained no priests or Latin scholars, only Bibles written in their native tongue of English. 65 days later, they landed in Cape Cod. They are better known as the Pilgrims.